twice driven back by heavy southwestern gales. Her Majesty's ship Beagle, a 10-gun brig, under the command of Captain Fitzroy, R.N., sailed from Devonport on the 27th of December, 1831. The object of the expedition was to survey Patagonia and Tierra del Fuego, the shores of Chile, Peru, and some islands in the Pacific, and to carry a chain of chronometrical measurement around the world. Sailing a little south of the Plata one very dark night, the sea presented a beautiful spectacle. Every part of the surface glowed with the pale light. The vessel drove before her bows two billows of liquid phosphorus, and in her wake she was followed by a milky train. The crest of every wave was bright, and the sky above the horizon, from the reflected flare of these livid flames, was not so utterly obscure as over the vault of the heavens. We weighed anchor early in the morning and left Port Famine. Captain Fitzroy determined to leave the strait by the Magellan Channel, which had not long been discovered. Our course lay due south, down that gloomy passage which appears to lead to another and worse world. The wind was fair. The dark, ragged clouds driven over the mountains, their jagged points, cones of snow, blue glaciers marked on a lurid sky. We anchored at Cape Turn, close to Mount Sarmiento, hidden in the clouds. Man sometimes wanders into these desolate regions, but it would be difficult to imagine a scene where he has fewer claims or less authority. The inanimate works of nature, rock, ice, snow, wind and water, all warring with each other, yet combined against man, have reigned in absolute sovereignty. The land birds of the Galapagos form a most singular group of finches, related to each other in the structure of their beaks. Seeing this gradation and diversity of structure in one small, intimately related group of birds, one might really fancy that from an original paucity of birds in this archipelago, one species had been taken and modified to different ends. November 26th, in the evening, we had a farewell view of the mountains of Tahiti. December 19th, in the evening, we saw in the distance New Zealand. We may now consider that we have nearly crossed the Pacific. Sailing over this great ocean for weeks, nothing but the same blue, profoundly deep. Even the islands are mere specks. How infinitely small the dry land is to the water of this vast expanse. Every league was one league nearer to England. These antipodes call to one's mind old recollections of childish doubt and wonder. Only the other day, I looked forward to this airy barrier as a definite point in our voyage homewards. But now I find it, and all such resting places for the imagination, are like shadows, which a man moving onwards cannot catch. After several tedious days from clouded weather, on the 14th of March, we gladly stood out of King George's Sound on our course to Keeling Island. Farewell, Australia. You are a rising child, and doubtless someday will reign a great princess in the South. You are too great and ambitious for affection, yet not great enough for respect. I leave your shores without sorrow or regret. On the 2nd of October, we made the shores of England. And at Falmouth, I left the Beagle, having lived on board the good little vessel nearly 5 years. I have too deeply enjoyed the voyage not to recommend to any naturalist, although he must not expect to be so fortunate in his companions as I have been, to take all chances and to start on travels by land if possible, if otherwise on a long voyage.